Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Steps Out of Time, One Woman's Journey on the Camino, by Katharine B. Soper, narrated by Donna Postel. For Philip, Chris, Katie, Megan, Colin. Give me my scallop shell of quiet, my staff of faith to walk upon, my scrip of joy, immortal diet, my bottle of salvation, my gown of glory, hope's true gauge, and thus I'll take my pilgrimage. Sir Walter Raleigh, Pilgrimage, 1604. Prologue. One morning in 1982, I flushed my gold watch down the toilet. 2 decades later, the memory of that incident sent me on a 500-mile walk across northern Spain on the centuries-old pilgrim trail to Santiago de Compostela. That morning in 1982 had been the usual multitasking whirlwind. I had just nursed my infant daughter, and with my mind on work and my eyes on my 15-month-old son, I was removing my watch before stepping into the shower. Suddenly it slipped through my hands, disappearing down the toilet bowl. I felt terrible about the watch, a lovely birthday gift from my husband Philip. But I had no time for regrets. I was due in court in 45 minutes and had to move on. After a quick shower, I struggled into my detested pantyhose, suited up, and crammed the day's pleadings into my briefcase. Then I gathered up my sweet-smelling babies and held them close, loving those few precious moments before the sitter arrived and I had to dash out the door. The years flew by. Before I knew it, my babies were taller than I was. I'd left practice for an administrative position at the University of Michigan. Philip, a law professor, continued to find satisfaction in his scholarship and teaching. Our marriage had the usual ups and downs, as we juggled family life and two demanding careers. But both of us, having escaped unhappy first marriages, knew how lucky we were to have found each other. Life was good. Still, I was becoming increasingly weary of a life lived in quarter-hour increments of obligations and responsibilities, with every moment scheduled and demanding an accounting. And yet, at the end of the day, I never seemed to have accomplished everything on my list. Sometimes I would fantasize about leading a simpler, less complicated life. But how? All of the activities and chores that consumed my time were without question essential. Not that I ever considered abandoning any of them. The problem, I would inevitably conclude, came down to simple math. Not enough hours in the day. If only I could increase my efficiency. Every now and then, I'd notice a pretty gold watch on a friend's wrist, and the memory of mine disappearing down the toilet would return. I'd laugh, recalling how busy my life had been back then. But I was avoiding the truth. My daily pace, if anything, had only accelerated as I grew more adept at multitasking. Sometimes the image of my watch twirling around in the toilet bowl would give me pause. Time disappearing before my eyes, I'd think. But I'd soon be laughing at myself again, this time for even considering the absurd possibility that my drowned watch signaled anything other than clumsiness. Then my father died. Dad had been a loving presence in my life since the day he returned from World War II to meet his year-old daughter, me, for the first time. The oldest of three girls, I inherited my father's adventurous temperament. He introduced me to many of his interests, which led to my lifelong passions for traveling, walking, jazz, skiing, and gourmet pleasures. For more than 50 years, Dad was my cheerleader, sounding board, reality check. Well, he tried. And a great role model for how to embrace life to the fullest. His death left an emptiness that even the demands of my very full life could not fill. The year after my father died, our son left for college, and the next year our daughter did the same. Thrilled as I was to see them eager and bright-eyed at this new stage, waves of nostalgia greeted me when I sat down at the breakfast table, still set with four placemats. And the hits kept coming. Leadership changes at the University of Michigan were going to affect my position. But how? I learned that I had osteoporosis. Then I was diagnosed with Sjogren's syndrome, a chronic disease of the immune system. Meanwhile, my 60th birthday was looming. Faced with a milestone birthday, the death of my father, an empty nest, professional uncertainty, and for the first time in my life, limitations imposed by health, I suddenly felt vulnerable and acutely mortal. Propelled by all of this, along with a series of curious coincidences, I decided to leave everything behind and head for Santiago de Compostela. What force throws people who were only yesterday considered reasonable into likely difficulties and certain discomfort? Jean-Claude Bourlas, Le Grand Chemin de Compostelle. Chapter 1. I'm off. May 26th to 27th, 2002. Ann Arbor, Michigan, to Bayonne, France. I am about to dissolve into a puddle on the pavement, right in front of curbside check-in at Detroit Metro Airport.
How can you leave me to go walking in Spain for 40 days? Philip demands, glaring at me angrily from the driver's seat.
This is not how I want my trip to begin. I feel like wailing. But I don't say anything.
I hesitate a moment, then grab my little purple and gray day pack, my only luggage for the next 40 days, from the back seat. My husband gets out of the car and heads for the sidewalk, his face a thundercloud.
I brace myself. It's a beautiful spring evening. How can a single human figure, a speck against the vast evening sky, make this lovely night so bleak?
I would never leave you for that long, he accuses, as he shoves into my hand the hat I had left on the seat. Why can't we spend the last weeks of our sabbatical relaxing together in Ann Arbor? Why are you being so unreasonable?
This has been his refrain all the way to the airport. Granted, Philip has never been what you'd call enthusiastic about my idea of walking the 500-mile pilgrimage trail to Santiago de Compostela. When I first broached the possibility, 9 months ago, he made it clear that he had no intention of walking this Camino thing with me, whatever it was, and as far as he was concerned, that was that. But it wasn't. I continued to explore the possibility, leaving books about the Camino around the house and mentioning it from time to time. Eventually, the objections stopped, and I took his silence as tacit acceptance. After more than 2 decades together, I should have known better, but I was so intrigued by the idea of walking to Santiago that I closed my eyes to the obvious. Silence equals brooding. Now, just hours before my departure, all his suppressed unhappiness erupts, catching me by surprise. And we're back to where we were 9 months ago. Two lawyers making their cases. Compounding his unhappiness with my plan is the timing. It's not ideal. Only 2 weeks earlier, we had returned to our Ann Arbor home after a sabbatical in Paris, just in time for our son's college graduation. We'd had a wonderful time abroad, and Philip wanted to ride out the afterglow at home together. In retrospect, I don't think he believed until today, the day of my departure, that I would turn right around and go back to Europe less than a week after the graduation festivities. By the time we pull up to the curb, I finally understand that nothing I can say will win his approval. I've lost my case.
He can't imagine why anyone would want to walk 500 miles. In spite of my reassurances and suggestion that he come with me, it's pretty clear he feels abandoned by my taking off on what he views as a month-long vacation in Europe. For what else could it be? Without him. The only thing that would appease him would be for me to change my mind and stay home. And I can't. I don't want to. I need to take this trip, even if I don't, in his opinion, have a rational explanation for why. How can you leave me for 40 days? He repeats. This is crazy. I know that behind the anger, he's also feeling hurt and worried about me. He keeps dwelling on the time I somersaulted off a trail in the Dolomites and cracked a few ribs before a friend saved me from sailing into oblivion. I wish he'd get over that. I have my concerns, too, and his anger saps my confidence. Now that I'm about to move from planning to execution, the excitement I felt when I stepped into the car to go to the airport has morphed into a knot in the pit of my stomach. What if I can't walk that far? What if I get lost or sick or tumble down a steep section of the trail with nobody to catch me this time? What if Philip is right? We stand together in the unsparing silence. He looks at me. I look at my shoes. A security cop drives by and points first at our car, then at his watch. Tears of frustration and anger drip down my cheeks. Why must expressing my opinions and desires so often result in a battle of wills? I pick up my backpack and start toward the terminal. "Wait," says Philip, reaching for my arm. "Don't leave like this." He pulls me into an embrace, the anger replaced by another look I can't identify. We hug, awkwardly at first, and then I look up and feel myself sinking into his blue eyes. Sometimes he makes me crazy. Sometimes we make each other crazy. But I really do love this man. Perhaps I will just stay here, safely wrapped up in the warmth of his strong, familiar arms. "No, you don't," I tell myself. "You've got too much invested in this trip. Get your butt on the plane." Swiping at my face with my sleeve, I pull away. He holds out his hands invitingly, then sighs, defeated. "Call me every day," he says. "Be careful. I love you."
"I love you too,"
I sniffle back. Touching his cheek with my hand, I promise to try to call at least weekly, dig out my passport, and after a last embrace, I'm on my way. With no luggage but my small pack, not even a purse for the first time in my adult life, I breeze through airport security and head for the gate, both hands free. Other passengers struggle with heavy suitcases and overflowing totes while juggling cell phones, portable media players, and countless other gadgets. That's usually me. More stuff than I can possibly need, and way more than I can comfortably carry. I savor the novel feeling of walking unencumbered down an airport concourse, but I'm flattened and demoralized by this last argument with Philip. I can't get beyond a rising tide of doubts. What if my joints act up and I'm miles from medical care? What if I fall and break one of my honeycombed bones? And what was I thinking when I packed one change of clothes for a 40-day trip? I inhale deeply, reminding myself that I'm taking the first steps of a journey I want to be on, and I'll never know if I can do it unless I try. It would be self-defeating to turn aside my dream of walking the Camino just because of health issues that might, or might not, be a problem. I vow, then and there, to put Sjogren's and osteoporosis out of my mind until I get home. As for the limited wardrobe, well, there is nothing I can do about my packing decisions at this point, so I'll just have to get used to the clothes I'll be wearing for the next 40 days. A lot can happen in 40 days. Lost in thought, I walk right past my gate. Not a great start for someone who expects to navigate her way across Spain. By the time I find it, the Air France jumbo jet to Paris is ready for boarding. I get in line with my 400 fellow travelers, who push and shove as they jockey for a spot in the overhead compartment for their impossibly large carry-ons. I slip my day pack into a corner of the overhead bin and claim my seat. Surrounded by the depressing solitude of a packed airplane, I sit and brood. I fuss with my water bottle, put my glasses in my shirt pocket, take them out, return them, and finally close my eyes to try to sleep. But my mind is racing. What am I doing? Why did I think I could do this? I put my glasses back on and stare out the window into the night. "Well, folks, we're next for departure," announces the captain. The whine of the engines escalates to an ominous roar. I think about bolting, but before I can formulate a plan, the plane is airborne. As the lights of Detroit fade away, I'm hit by the same anguish. Or is it guilt that overtakes me every time I do something for myself, even if it's just stopping by the mall on the way home from work? Philip is right. I am being selfish and irresponsible to leave behind family and other obligations and go off on a month-long adventure because of some vague notion that I'm meant to do it. Something awful is bound to happen to one of my children or my husband, or my elderly mother will become ill and I won't be there to help. And of course, there's the standard worry about the plane crashing. Those several minutes of sheer terror while I careen toward the sea, my body broken into smithereens when I hit the water, leaving my loved ones to pick up the pieces. My seatmate looks worried, too, as she watches me nervously bouncing my foot back and forth and stares at the shredded boarding pass in my lap. She starts to say something, but changes her mind, turns away and opens her book. I wish desperately that I had a book to read. Then it occurs to me that it's because of a damned book that I'm strapped into this airplane seat. Last September, I had dashed into Borders to pick up a birthday gift and careened straight into a display table that featured Shirley MacLaine's book about her pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela, The Camino, A Journey of the Spirit. The cover stopped me in my tracks. It showed a photo of a solitary figure, presumably MacLaine, striding across a field of tall grass, snow-covered peaks in the background. She was wearing a humongous pack, carrying a pilgrim's staff, and head down, she appeared both purposeful and pensive. This image had made my heart pound. How I longed to be that woman. As I stared at the photo, I could see myself decades earlier, not yet consumed by all the things I would achieve: career, professional and community responsibilities, house and garden, cars, an avalanche of mail, a packed calendar every minute of every day, and caught a glimpse of the freedom and possibility that were so much a part of who I was, the me that used to be. I bought the book and read it straight through that very night. Pilgrim stories have fascinated me ever since I first learned about the ancient trail to Santiago de Compostela as a graduate student in French literature in the 1970s. But I hadn't known that the trail still existed and that people continued to walk it until I read MacLaine's book. A few days later, it hit me. I had a window of opportunity when I could hike this trail, or at least try. In January, I would begin a 7-month leave of absence that would coincide with Philip's upcoming sabbatical. We planned to be in Paris until mid-May, and after that, I would have no commitments until early August, when I had to return to work. For the first time in my adult life, I would have over 2 months with no professional or family obligations. And those 2 months were prime time for walking the Camino. Nothing stood in the way but my own fears and indecision. A month after that chance encounter at Borders, I happened upon the pilgrimage trail again, this time during a trip to Oregon with my friend B, whom I had first met during my days as a French instructor at Boise State some 30 years earlier. We joined up in Portland, where we planned to spend the day before driving to the Oregon coast for a hiking trip. B and I both love bookstores, so our first stop was Powell's, a book lover's paradise. As always, I headed immediately for the travel section, where a blonde, ponytailed young man with intense blue eyes was shelving books. "Like to walk?" he said, holding out a copy of The Lonely Planet Guide to Walking in Spain. I nodded, startled at his choice of books. How did he know the idea of a trip to Spain was rumbling around in the back of my mind? "Hang on," he replied, fumbling to find the page he wanted. "You might want to consider this hike," he said, pointing to a long wavy line on a map. "It runs for 500 miles across northern Spain. It's called the Camino." Heart pounding, I took the book out of his hands and headed for the checkout counter. The chapter on the Camino captivated me. The walk sounded fantastic, full of historical sights and remarkable scenery, with great food and wine all along the way. It was a bit long, but the terrain sounded easy and the route finding straightforward. A week later, when I got back to Ann Arbor, still brimming with enthusiasm, I began talking about my idea of walking the Camino with family and friends. To my surprise, they all reacted with some combination of disbelief, ridicule, or confusion. The comment that stung most, however, came from my youngest sister. "Having a midlife crisis, are we?" she said. "I'm not in crisis," I huffed, irritated by the suggestion that there was anything wrong with my life. "And at 57, it's pretty optimistic to call me middle-aged." In fact, everyone thought I'd lost my mind, except our 2 children. "Go for it, Mom," they exclaimed when I told them of my plan. The boundless energy and fearless optimism of youth in action, I thought. Then I remembered my dad and knew that the willingness to embrace an adventure, to take a chance, was a matter of attitude, not age. He would have loaded my backpack and laughed at my hesitation as he pushed me out the door. My children's enthusiasm and the memory of Dad helped keep the disparaging comments at bay, and I continued to dream about walking to Santiago. Nevertheless, I was still undecided when we left for our sabbatical in Europe. And that's when another fortuitous event intervened. From the Lonely Planet Guide, I had learned about a London-based organization, the Confraternity of St. James, that offers a range of support to pilgrims to Santiago. As luck would have it, Philip and I had decided to spend 10 days in London on the way to Paris. So I tucked the address and phone number of the confraternity office in my passport, thinking I might give them a call. But when we got to London, I kept finding reasons not to phone. Finally, 2 days before we were to continue on to Paris, I dialed the number. "I'm thinking about walking the Camino this spring," I told the woman who answered the phone. "Do you have any information about the route?" "Yes, indeed," she exclaimed, "and your timing is perfect. Our annual Practical Pilgrim's Day is tomorrow morning, beginning at 10. I think you'd find it well worth your time. Do come. No need to register in advance. Just stop by." I go to enough meetings at work to last me a lifetime, I thought. Why would I go to one for fun? And I don't like large groups, especially when I don't know anyone. Besides, Philip and I had planned to go to the Tate Modern the next day, our last full day in London. But I knew, in my heart of hearts, that this was my moment of truth. The following morning, Philip headed for the Tate, alone, while I went to the confraternity office on Blackfriars Road. Pilgrim Associations. In 2001, when I was struggling to decide whether to make my first pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela, information about the Camino was not readily available. There were no Camino associations in North America, and online resources were just catching on. By chance, I stumbled on the London-based Confraternity of St. James, csj.org.uk. This serendipitous encounter was instrumental in my decision to walk to Santiago, alone and on foot. Today, many organizations throughout the world promote and facilitate the pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela. Other English-language Camino associations include American Pilgrims on the Camino, americanpilgrims.org, the Canadian Company of Pilgrims, santiago.com, the Confraternity of St. James of South Africa, csjofsa.za.org, and the Camino Society Ireland, caminosociety.ie. Most European countries have at least one, if not several, active Camino associations. There are also many in South America, and at least one each in Japan, South Korea, and the Philippines. For a list of confraternities and associations in non-English-speaking countries, go to the Santiago Pilgrim Office website, www.oficinadelperegrino.com/en. Select Preparation, then select Confraternities Worldwide. From the minute an enthusiastic confraternity member greeted me at the door, I knew I'd made the right decision. Patient and helpful veteran pilgrims answered questions from would-be pilgrims on a range of topics for over 2 hours. Route finding, health and safety issues, finances, when to go, what to bring, whether to stay in the primitive pilgrim shelters called refugios, and more. Several women asked whether it was safe to walk alone, a concern I shared. The no-nonsense advice of a twinkly-eyed, gray-haired Englishwoman who had walked just about every route to Santiago more than once, put that fear, if not to rest, at least in perspective. "You're better off going alone," she laughed. "You can't know what you're getting into with someone else, especially a spouse. Be your own good company and get to know yourself." Also at the Practical Pilgrim's Day, I learned of a 12th century book about the pilgrimage to Santiago that is sometimes referred to as the world's first travel guide. Written in Latin around 1140, the Pilgrim's Guide describes the four main pilgrimage trails to Santiago from France and gives advice about the route. The book addresses concerns so eternally human that the 900-year-old account seems astonishingly contemporary. I loved the author's tales of marauding robbers, poisonous waters, and treacherous ferrymen, as well as his colorful descriptions of the landscape, people, food, and places to visit along the way. The pull of the trip was becoming irresistible. I left the confraternity meeting with a growing confidence I could do it, a confidence based on facts and detailed information that bolstered my gut sense that I should not let this opportunity slip. Once Philip and I got to Paris, my encounters with things Camino accelerated, and I soon decided they were not coincidences, but rather signs, all pointing me toward Santiago de Compostela. These included running into a French woman about my age at Compostel 2000, the Parisian equivalent of the Confraternity of St. James. She had just returned from walking to Santiago from Paris, a journey of over 1,000 miles. We talked for most of an hour, femme a femme, as she put it, and as we parted ways, she invited me to call her with any questions. Then, sensing my hesitation, she offered words of encouragement that I would recall several times during my pilgrimage. "Don't be afraid," she said. "There really is a force that looks out for you. The Camino is more than a place. You'll see what I mean. Finally, one decisive Friday, after 3 random encounters with the pilgrimage to Santiago in a 12-hour period, I jumped off the emotional fence once and for all and phoned for a round-trip plane ticket to Europe, leaving Detroit in late May and returning 40 days later. Later that week, I started brushing up on my Spanish, compiling my packing list, and taking daily cross-Paris walks to break in my new shoes and get in shape to walk 500 miles. And here I am, I think, Santiago bound. The captain announces that we've reached cruising altitude. My foot tapping has stopped. A grumbling stomach reminds me I haven't had any dinner, a casualty of all that arguing. As I stare out the window into the void, an unexpected grin comes over my face. I love adventures, and I have a feeling this will be a doozy. I put my glasses in my shirt pocket, pull a blanket around my shoulders, and finally fall fast asleep. I wake to the sound of rain against the window and the captain's announcement that we're on our final approach. Minutes later, we land at Charles de Gaulle Airport, right on time. It's an easy trip on the RER train from the airport into central Paris, then a short metro ride to the Gare Montparnasse, where I will meet Juliet, a French friend, and my last-minute traveling companion. Until 2 weeks ago, I expected to walk to Santiago de Compostela alone, not by choice, but because I couldn't persuade anyone to come with me. Nobody I knew had the time or slightest interest, especially after I went into the details, like the distance involved and the primitive dormitory-style accommodations. Eventually, bolstered by the comments of the English woman at the Confraternity of St. James and the French woman at Compostelle 2000, I convinced myself that it was okay, and maybe even preferable, to walk alone. Then, just days before Philip and I returned home from our Paris sabbatical, a conversation with Juliet at a favorite bistro led me to reconsider my decision. She and I first met decades ago, when I was a college student on a junior year in France, and she was a skinny, buck-toothed 10-year-old. Our fathers were business acquaintances who had become friends, so when her family learned I was studying in Paris, they invited me to their home in the heart of Burgundy, and that was the beginning of my long relationship with the entire family. Initially, Juliet had been like a kid sister, but gradually our 10-year age difference mattered less and less, and we became friends. Our adult lives have had striking parallels. We are both professional women who have survived painful divorces. We had babies about the same time, and we share a love of good food and good books. We discovered something else in common over lunch at that Paris bistro, when I casually mentioned my plans to walk the Camino. "Can I come?" Juliet blurted out in French. "I've been thinking about making this pilgrimage for some time. Now would be perfect. I really need a break. Would you mind?" Hardly anyone I had talked with in the United States had ever heard of the pilgrimage to Santiago, so I was astonished that she not only knew all about it, but actually wanted to go. On reflection, I should not have been surprised. This pilgrimage has been part of French cultural heritage since the year 950, when a bishop named Godescalc walked to Santiago from central France. French pilgrims have been going there ever since. So, of course, Juliet knew about the pilgrimage, and even had friends who had walked it. Now what? By the time of our bistro lunch, I had gotten used to the idea that I would go alone, and it felt right. Yet the Camino is a public path, open to everyone. Besides, Juliet was reeling from the breakup of a relationship, and maybe a pilgrimage was just what she needed to help put her life back together. "Think about it," she said. "Call me tomorrow after you've slept on the idea, and we can talk." When I told Philip about her proposal, and that she planned to take a cell phone, an item I felt unnecessary, He jumped on the idea. At least I'd have a way to reach you, he said, and someone would be there if you had a problem.
That night, as I was trying to figure out what to do, my eyes settled on a French priest's account of his Camino journey that I was reading at the time. Il faut se laisser faire, he kept repeating, loosely translated as, chill out and let things happen. What a concept, and one that was utterly foreign to me. He was referring to nothing less than letting go of control over my life, checking out to my pre-pilgrimage way of thinking. But I had to admit that there would be many things I simply could not control while on the pilgrim trail, like the weather, or how my body would react to walking all day, every day for a month, or whether I would make it home in one piece. A bit dramatic, perhaps, but the possibility did cross my mind. Maybe I need to be a little more flexible, I thought. Maybe this development with Juliet is the first test of my readiness to walk the pilgrimage trail. The next morning, I accepted her proposal to accompany me. But can you get ready in time? I asked, knowing that it had taken me months to compile a packing list and train for the walk.
Bien sûr,
she replied, without missing a beat. That settled, we agreed to meet, in 14 days, at a Paris train station, and travel together to Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, a French village at the foot of the Pyrenees, where we would begin walking. On the appointed day, I arrive at the Gare Montparnasse about 3 hours before our scheduled departure, happy for the chance to walk around the neighborhood and stretch my legs after some 9 hours jammed into an economy seat on an overbooked plane. Later, I have lunch at a sidewalk cafe before returning to the cavernous station, where I join the hordes waiting in front of an electronic bulletin board for their tracks to be posted. The numbers on the board twirl around noisily every 5 minutes for what seems like forever. Finally, in reality, after less than half an hour, a number is posted in front of the TGV, Train de Grande Vitesse, or high-speed train, to Bayonne, where we will catch the connecting train to Saint-Jean. I go to the track and look around. No Juliet. 10 minutes pass, and still no sign of her. I begin to wonder if she changed her mind. It all happened so fast, this decision to walk the Camino together. I can't call her, since I don't have either a cell phone or a French phone card. So I go over the reasons I had wanted to walk alone, just in case. The loudspeaker announces our train's imminent departure. I get on the train, and there she is, installed in her seat. 30 years ago, the gangly kid had blossomed into a beautiful woman, and today, as usual, Juliet looks fabulous, all smiles and very elegant. Her blonde highlighted hair is perfectly coiffed, her makeup exquisitely subtle. Exuding charm, she wears slim khaki pants, a freshly ironed white shirt tucked in to show off her tiny waist, and a red sweater tied casually around her shoulders. Gold earrings, a stack of gold bracelets, and new gray hiking boots trimmed in red complete her outfit. She has, somehow, managed to hoist onto the luggage rack her enormous backpack, also new. I try to slide it over to make room for my pack, but it won't budge. It appears to be filled with poured concrete. I'm happy to see my longtime friend, but next to such glamour, I feel incredibly dumpy. Actually, I always feel that way in Paris, even though I usually dress several steps above Ann Arbor casual when I go to France. I tower over most French women and men. I'm not a size zero. I don't wear stilettos anymore because they hurt my feet. My naturally curly mop is not in style, and I wear glasses, also not stylish. But this time, especially after spending the night on an airplane, I'm downright embarrassed by my appearance. My khaki hiking pants are rumpled,
my baggy blue hiking shirt untucked. I wear the ugliest footwear I've ever owned, a pair of sensible English walking shoes that look like clown shoes on my size 11 feet. Second thoughts creep in about my decision to bring only functional clothes and not to take any jewelry or makeup. Juliet seems not to notice my new look. She rushes up, offering a flourish of greetings. After quickly kissing each other on both cheeks, we take our seats as the train pulls out of the station. We begin to catch up on family news, but I soon crash, exhausted from the long flight and lulled by the soothing whisper of the train. Juliet wakes me at sunset as we arrive in Bayonne, a bustling town in the heart of the French Basque Country. We couldn't get there in time to catch the last connecting train to Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, so we have reserved a room for the night in a charming hotel in the old part of town. And while we were at it, we also reserved a hotel for the next night in Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, so we could get off to a good start. We'll have a nice dinner, then take the first train to Saint-Jean tomorrow morning. And tomorrow, the adventure begins. A light pack, to remind me that I am only passing through this world, and that the only baggage I will take up there is the love I gave down here. Luc Adrien, Compostelle, Carnet de route du Pèlerin. Chapter 2. Decisions, decisions. May 28, Bayonne to Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port. Despite sleeping through two alarm clocks, Juliet and I somehow managed to throw on clothes and dash to the station in time to catch the 7 a.m. train. The dilapidated one-car local is packed, but two heavy-set American men in their 50s move their gear off the wooden bench and make a space for us. Within minutes, we are in the midst of lush green mountains as we rattle past fast-flowing streams and an occasional hamlet. The hillsides are speckled with gently swaying white dots, grazing sheep, it turns out. An hour later, the little train bounces into the medieval village of Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port. Nestled in the gentle curves of the Pyrenees, the village on this beautiful morning looks like a travel poster for southwest France. Window boxes, crammed with colorful summer flowers, perch on the sides of centuries-old half-timbered houses. The town's cobblestone streets wind past the 14th-century Gothic church and along the banks of the River Nive, while the hazy blue Pyrenees stand guard over Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port's 2,000 inhabitants. The name translates as St. John at the foot of the pass and reflects the town's location on a 12th-century pilgrimage trail as it goes over a pass in the Pyrenees to reach Spain. From there, the trail crosses three more mountain ranges and a vast plain called the Meseta before reaching its destination, the Shrine of St. James in Santiago de Compostela. In centuries past, this little town offered respite to weary European pilgrims who arrived on foot from their homes before they began the difficult and often dangerous crossing of the Pyrenees. These days, some Europeans still start walking from their doorsteps, and for them, Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port continues to be a stop on the way to Santiago. Tens of thousands more arrive each year from all over the world via 21st-century transportation to start their pilgrimage in Saint-Jean on the route that has become known as the Camino Francaise, or simply the Camino. A brief history of the pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela. Santiago de Compostela in northwestern Spain has been a popular destination for pilgrims since the early Middle Ages because the crypt of its cathedral is said to contain the bones of St. James. James was one of Jesus' 12 disciples, along with his brother John. After the crucifixion, he was beheaded by Herod in 44 AD, and according to the tradition, his body made its way to Spain on a stone boat, which landed on the coast near what is now Santiago. James was buried on a nearby hill by his followers and forgotten until the year 813, when a Christian hermit named Pelayo followed a path of stars to rediscover James's remains. The local bishop authenticated the bones, and a chapel was built to house them, in what would become the city of Santiago de Compostela. Soon the relics began attracting pilgrims from all over Europe. The name of the city reflects both the name of the saint and the reason the site was chosen. Santiago means St. James in Spanish, and Compostela is said to come from the Latin Campus Stellae, or Field of Stars, in reference to the stars that led Pelayo to discover the relics. By the 11th century, the pilgrimage to Santiago de Compostela had grown to become one of the three main pilgrimage destinations in medieval Europe, rivaling those to Rome and Jerusalem. An infrastructure, roads, bridges, towns with an array of services, hospices, churches, soon developed. This not only benefited pilgrims, but also fueled local economies and was a major influence in opening up European trade routes. Pilgrims traveled to Santiago in large numbers throughout the Middle Ages. During the Reformation, the numbers declined precipitously and then dropped further during the Enlightenment. In the mid-20th century, the pilgrimage to Santiago experienced a resurgence, largely due to the efforts of Spanish priests and scholars to promote the centuries-old tradition. From the early days of this pilgrimage, many roads led to Santiago, starting from departure points all over Europe. One of the most widely traveled routes, the Camino Frances, gathered pilgrims coming from France, Germany, and Italy in a village at the foot of the Pyrenees. From there, it took them over a pass into Spain, then across northern Spain to Santiago. In 1987, the Camino Frances was named Europe's first cultural itinerary in recognition of its historical and cultural importance. UNESCO declared the Camino a World Heritage Site in 1993, along with such treasures as the pyramids, Machu Picchu, and the Great Wall of China. Today, the pilgrimage to Santiago attracts visitors from all over the world who come as tourists, scholars, adventurers, athletes, and yes, even pilgrims. Saint-Jean is just waking up when we arrive. Merchants raise iron security grates and sweep the steps in front of their stores. Cafe waiters in black pants and white shirts set out sidewalk tables and chairs. Townspeople walk briskly to work. Our first order of business is breakfast. Wandering through town, we discover an open pastry shop with outdoor tables and a sign proclaiming that it specializes in gâteau basque, delicious butter cakes with a custard filling, parfait. We take the table next to a massive planter of fire engine red geraniums and settle in, sampling pastries and drinking one excellent coffee after another while we enjoy the morning quiet and write in our journals. The journal is an idea I picked up at the Practical Pilgrim's Day in London. All the experienced pilgrims I met at that event insisted that a journal was standard equipment for a pilgrimage. One man even claimed that a journal was the most critical piece of equipment because it would encourage us to reflect upon the journey once we returned home. And these post-trip musings, in his view, were an essential part of the experience. He was persuasive. Although I had not kept a diary since junior high school, I started my new journal that day in London and wrote in it daily over the following months. The sound of creaky wheels makes Juliet and me look up from our writing. It's the two heavy-set men from the train wobbling past, on bicycles. I do a double take. Enormous, bulging saddlebags are draped over the rear wheels, and deep wicker baskets, also stuffed to overflowing, hang from the front handlebars. These men apparently share Juliet's philosophy of packing. We start to wave, then hesitate because they seem so unsteady, and struggle with even the slight incline of this modest slope. Shaking our heads, we exchange smug looks. If they can do it, you bet we can, Juliet observes confidently. I relish the warmth of the sun and the spicy fragrance of the geraniums, as I lick my fingers and decide whether to have another gâteau basque or try something different, perhaps a chocolate éclair. I'm not sure what it's like to be on a pilgrimage, but this feels pretty good, I comment. I guess we're not going as hardcore pilgrims. Juliette tosses back her head and laughs. Oh, no. Me? I'm more of an epicure, she says, moving her face to catch the sun's rays. Well, that's a relief, because I don't see myself as a pilgrim either. Everyone knows that pilgrims are religious fanatics who reject the world and turn their backs on all earthly pleasures and responsibilities. A long-lapsed Methodist like me, who goes to church on Christmas Eve and Easter, and then only for the music, can't be a pilgrim. Besides, my life as a lawyer and university administrator is firmly anchored in the here and now, in the rational. And yet, my decision to walk the Camino was not exactly rational. I decide not to worry about this detail and order a strawberry tart. Then Juliette and I talk about some practical considerations. First is the question of where we'll stay, at the traditional pilgrim shelters called refugios, or the more comfortable and more expensive accommodations along the way, such as pensiones and hotels. The refugios, also called albergues, offer dormitory-style beds for just a few euros to pilgrims en route to Santiago. But they are reputed to be dirty, crowded, plagued by snorers, and you can't reserve a bed in advance. This last point was a huge hurdle for me as I was contemplating the trip. It took me weeks to get my mind around the idea that if I stayed in refugios, I wouldn't know whether I'd even have a bed to sleep in at night, much less where. But I finally had to accept that I couldn't reserve ahead in any event, because it would be impossible to know how far I would get each day, given all the things I couldn't control. The weather, unexpected route changes, an injury or illness, getting lost, and a host of other unforeseen events. Attacks by wild dogs. What got me over this hump was thinking about the hundreds of thousands of pilgrims who had made it to Santiago over the centuries without reservations and survived the experience. Now, faced with making an actual decision, my ambivalence comes slinking back. I haven't shared a room with a total stranger, much less 30 or more, since my freshman year in college, and that was a disaster. On the other hand, the choice of overnight lodging will have a big impact on my budget. Just as important, I want to experience this journey in the traditional way, even if I'm technically not a pilgrim, and everyone knows that pilgrims stay in refugios. Let's try out a refugio tomorrow night, I say to Juliette. I'm game if you are.
I have a different idea, she says. Let's continue staying in hotels at first, while we ease into the trip, and of course after difficult stages, when we'll need our comfort and a reward for hard work. We can try refugios after a few days, once we've found our equilibrium.
My shaky resolve vanishes, and I quickly agree. That settled, we turn to the question of what time to start off. We know we must leave early, since the first day is such a long one, but we run into a snag over breakfast. Bakeries here don't open until 7:30, so I suggest buying a baguette and some fruit and yogurt today, having breakfast in our room around 6, and leaving by 7 at the latest. Juliette, however, points out that yesterday's baguette would be stale by morning, and stale bread for breakfast is, in her view, impossible. This is so Juliette, I think, half annoyed at her unwillingness to adapt to the realities of a pilgrimage, and half agreeing with her that a day-old baguette, which has the texture of biscotti, is not an ideal way to start the day. Then an image runs through my head of the consequences of starting too late. We are huddled under a tree, whose menacing shadow looms over us, The dark sky churns angrily, and it's raining. Draped in a dripping wet designer poncho, Juliet is sitting, propped up against her giant pack. I'm soaked to the bone and shivering. Miserable, we wait in the downpour for dawn and enough light to continue. Meanwhile, the pastry shop waitress overhears our conversation and offers a suggestion.
C'est simple, she says. Our ghetto basques stay fresh for several days. Take some with you, and you'll have a delicious breakfast tomorrow before you start out. Et voilà, she proclaims, looking quite pleased that she's figured this out for us.
Pastries for breakfast? We instantly agree with her. We also decide that we need to carry food with us each day for lunch, in case we aren't near a town with a good restaurant at midday.
I have some emergency supplies, Juliet volunteers, just in case. 4 boxes of breakfast bars, some chocolates, nuts, and a few other things.
What a great travel companion, I think. Whatever happens, there's no way we'll go hungry. And with business out of the way, we order pastries we haven't yet sampled. A fabulous local specialty made with an almond meringue and praline buttercream called a chaumonté, and a millefeuille, also known as a Napoleon. It's now mid-morning, and the street is clogged with backpackers who spill over from the jammed sidewalks. They wear scallop shells around their necks or pinned on their hats or packs, a sign that they are pilgrims on the way to the shrine of St. James in Santiago. Scallops are plentiful on the coast near Santiago, so in the Middle Ages, pilgrims would take them home as proof of their journey. In French, a scallop shell is called a coquille Saint-Jacques, literally a St. James shell. Modern-day pilgrims have taken to wearing the shells from the beginning of their journey as a mark of intention rather than completion. We placidly observe the energetic crowd from our table in the sun. It's hard to move on, but eventually we shoulder our packs and go to our hotel, a small family-run place in the center of town. A bellboy shows us to our room, suppressing a grunt when he deposits Juliet's pack on the floor. As Juliet unpacks, I see that she is not about to risk being cold, hot, hungry, bedraggled, or bored. In addition to several outfits of various weights and a makeup kit, she has come prepared with large bottles of creams, lotions, and hair products, several books, extra shoes, and her emergency food supply, all items she considers essential. And of course, she has the standard pilgrim equipment of sleeping bag, rain gear, and water bottle. She figures that as long as she can lift her pack, she can carry it on her back. I am astounded at how much stuff she has, and she can't believe all the things I don't have. My approach was admittedly bare bones. I took to heart the recommendations of several Camino guidebooks, all of which urged a very sparse packing list. I also knew, from experience, that weight in a backpack translates directly into pain. With my osteoporosis and joint problems, I wasn't sure I would make it to Santiago even with a light pack, but I could maximize my chances. I decided to follow the Spartan advice of the Confraternity of St. James. Carry the lesser of 8 kilograms, or 10% of your body weight, which for me was 6.08 kilograms, 13.4 pounds. In the months before my departure, I labored over my packing list, weighing every item on a kitchen scale, then starting over when my pack exceeded the maximum weight I had allowed myself. I don't know if I was diligent or compulsive, but by the end of April, my fully loaded pack weighed 6.165 kilograms, and that included 1 liter of water, a change of clothes, toiletries for a month, a new extra-lightweight down sleeping bag, and the weight of my pack. Everything I would be carrying on my back, except for any food I bought along the way. In addition, I prepared a small waste pack in which I would carry valuables, passport, pilgrim credential, one family photo, cash, credit card, and an ATM card. Items I needed to have handy, clip-on sunglasses, lip balm, spoon, and a few small but heavy necessities, camera, extra batteries, mini headlamp. I planned to wear the waist pack across my stomach for easy access, and to keep it with me at all times, even in the shower, so that I wouldn't have to worry about theft of difficult-to-replace items. It weighed 960 grams, 2.1 pounds. Not bad. It was hard, not to mention completely out of character, to pack only one change of clothes. But that was nothing compared to the agonizing question of whether to take books. How could anyone be expected to pack for a 40-day trip, including two transatlantic flights, without books? How to cope with the hassles of traveling, where to go to escape, without books? But books are bulky and heavy, even paperbacks, when you are in the mindset of weighing every aspirin. And my pre-trip reading seemed to suggest that stripping down to the essentials meant leaving behind creature comforts. I waffled for days, but eventually decided I would go truly bare bones and leave my books at home. Reluctantly, and with trepidation, I packed only selected pages torn from a Camino guidebook and a small notebook to serve as my journal, minus the front and back covers to save an ounce or two. I did make one concession to vanity. Inspired by a character in a novel who made a pilgrimage to Santiago, I mailed a pretty sundress, a pair of strappy sandals, and makeup to the Santiago Hotel where I had reserved a room at the end of my trip. "Hold for arrival on June 30th, I wrote optimistically on the front of the box in big black letters. After a month of wearing the same clothes every day, I knew I would be desperate for a nice outfit to wear while I explored Santiago, and later for the trip home and my reunion with Philip. Juliet looks thoughtfully at my pack and considers the mountain of stuff on her bed. After deliberating a long time, she decides to mail home a few things she can do without: an extra sweater, a large bottle of styling gel, two heavy books, and a few other miscellaneous items, for a total of about 1.5 kilograms. So off we go to the post office. "This happens all the time," says the weary clerk. Then we visit the pastry shop, cheese shop, greengrocer, supermarket, and chocolatier, buying provisions for the next day. Our last stop is the Acque de Pelerin de l'Association des Amis du Chemin de Saint-Jacques, Pyrénées Atlantiques, a pilgrim welcome center in downtown Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port, which we must visit so Juliet can get her credential. Also called a pilgrim's passport, this document identifies the bearer as a pilgrim on the way to Santiago. It is a distant cousin of the safe conduct pass that medieval pilgrims secured from local authorities before leaving home and is required for access to the refugios. My credential, which I obtained at the Paris Pilgrim Association, came with a curious little observation. Or was it a warning? "Quelle que soit ta foi et ta relation à Dieu, en partant tu n'es plus le même." Whatever your faith, whatever your relationship with God, by your decision to leave on this pilgrimage, you are no longer the same person. Refugios and pilgrim centers all along the Camino stamp and date the credentials of passing pilgrims. And these little stamps provide a colorful record of a pilgrim's progress. This record also enables a pilgrim who makes it to Santiago to prove to church authorities that she has walked at least the last 100 kilometers or cycled the last 200 kilometers to Santiago. That proof, together with a statement that the journey was religiously motivated, earns the pilgrim a second document called a Compostela. Obtaining a Compostela was a major motivation for pilgrims in the Middle Ages because it officially recognized completion of the pilgrimage, and that in turn entitled the successful pilgrim to the remission of all or part of the time spent in purgatory. Essentially, a get-out-of-penance-free card. Today, travelers to Santiago remain eager to get their Compostela. Though, as often as not, I suspect it's because this handsome document, in Latin, with its official-looking seal, is a fine souvenir. The French Pilgrim Association is bustling and efficient. Juliette has her credential in no time. A friendly volunteer gives both of us our first stamp, a green one, with the image of a medieval pilgrim and mountains in the background. Buen camino, she wishes us as she stamps, dates, and signs our credentials with a flourish. This traditional salutation is the pilgrim equivalent of happy trails. She might be more excited about our trip than I am. This small French town is so comfortable, with its flower boxes and gardens, friendly merchants, and the buzz of a language I understand. The mountains that we must cross to get to Spain loom over the village. Tomorrow is, in fact, reputed to be the hardest day of the Camino, on a 27-kilometer trail that takes pilgrims over the Pyrenees and into Spain. But I know from my guidebook that there are two options for our first day of walking: the harder way and the hard way. The harder way, which was the traditional route, originated as a Roman track. Later, it became known as the Route de Napoleon, when the French emperor began using it in the early 19th century. Napoleon was not known for coddling his soldiers. The elevation chart shows exactly what we'd face on that route: a near vertical climb up and over the Pyrenees at the Sea's Pass, then a treacherously steep drop into Roncesvalles, Roncevaux in French. The author of the 12th century Pilgrim's Guide has this to say about the Route de Napoleon. Still in the Basque country, the road to St. James goes over a most lofty mountain known as the Portus Césaire, Sea's Pass. It is a journey of 8 miles up to the pass and another 8 down from it. The mountain is so high that it seems to touch the sky, and a man who has climbed it feels that he could indeed reach the sky with his hand. The other route, the Route de Charlemagne, follows the road for much of the way, stays lower, and crosses the mountains at the Ibañeta Pass. In the early days, either option was dangerous. Pilgrims taking the Route de Napoleon faced deadly, high mountain weather conditions and risked getting lost in fog or unexpected blizzards. If they took the lower route, they became targets for highwaymen who robbed and murdered them. Today, some 900 years later, the lower route, while less dramatic, is not only easier, but safer. We're not sure we're up to the high route on our first day of walking, but when I ask the association volunteer about the road route, she hands me a 1-page description for the Route de Napoleon and denies any knowledge of an alternative. I show her the page in my guidebook describing another option. She backpedals.
Well, maybe there is a road route.
Mais personne ne le prend, she insists. Personne, personne. But nobody takes it. Absolutely nobody. You really should take the Route de Napoleon.
I don't know, I say. It's our first day. Eh bien, do as you wish, she concludes, her voice dripping with disapproval.
Other volunteers appear, all eager to support their colleagues' sound advice. We try to thank her, but by now the volunteers are so engrossed in lively conversation that none of them pays us the slightest attention. Since then, the association has changed its advice. Volunteers, of which I am now one, hand out information in a dozen languages, describing both routes, and telling pilgrims that, in case of inclement weather, they must take the lower route. As we leave, the words of a British pilgrim, who's lounging in the doorway, clinch our decision not to take the Route de Napoleon.
Did you hear about the 3 girls who got lost at the Sea's Pass a few weeks ago? He asks us in a hushed voice.
His eyes dart about as if he thinks he's being watched.
They had to be rescued by the mountain patrol, he hisses. Lucky for them that someone wondered where they were, or they'd still be up there.
Juliet and I look at each other, somewhat alarmed. This guy is weird, we think. But what if he's telling the truth?
Then there was the Brazilian pilgrim earlier this season who wasn't rescued, he says darkly. The association volunteers told him not to attempt the pass that day, given weather conditions. But he wouldn't listen and headed out anyway. They figured he'd made it when he didn't come back. But since nobody was expecting him on the other end, nobody missed him there either. They found this one when the snow melted. Take care.
Well, this exchange puts a damper on our day. 21st century pilgrims aren't supposed to die en route to Santiago. It's a hiking trail, for heaven's sake. And like any other long-established European trail, it's surely safe. Isn't it? We walk back to our hotel in silence. When we get there, Juliet goes up to our room. Feeling restless, I take a stroll and end up on the graceful 15th century bridge over the River Neve that we will cross the next morning on our way out of town. I stand there for a long time, leaning against the cool stones and watching the motion of the water. It makes a muffled sound as it tumbles over the rocky stream bed. The silvery shadows of trout, flitting about effortlessly, create a dappled pattern in the sunlit water, and the stream keeps flowing, steadily, calmly, inevitably. I wonder where my journey will take me. Behind me lies the security of this little thousand-year-old village. Ahead of me, who can say? It was no picnic yet, let alone a pilgrimage. Colin Fletcher, The Man Who Walked Through Time. Chapter 3. Nobody said this would be easy. May 29th to 31st, Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port to La Soigne via Zubiri. Overnight, the weather turns. It's not quite raining when the alarm goes off at 6:30 a.m., but the sky is leaden in anticipation. While we pack up, we talk about our encounter with the spooky Englishman yesterday. His comments were unnerving, but after a good night's sleep, and in the light of day, we decide he was just trying to scare us with his tall tales of pilgrim deaths. We enjoy a leisurely snack of buttery gâteau basque and hand-dipped chocolates, settle our bill, and stride out the door of the hotel at 7:45. It has started to drizzle. We go back inside, dig out our bad weather gear, and try again. Within minutes, the drizzle turns into a steady, penetrating rain. No matter, we each have a voluminous, hooded, waterproof cape called a pelerin that fits over us and our backpacks and will keep both dry. I wasn't going to buy this traditional pilgrim garment, since I already had good rain gear, but the packing lists I consulted recommended taking a pelerin, so I decided to check out this unfamiliar piece of equipment while we were in Paris. Besides, that gave me an excuse to visit Le Vieux Camper, the old camper, a series of little shops in the Latin Quarter, each carrying a different type of outdoor equipment. It is my favorite store in all of Paris, and is just around the corner from the Rue Saint-Jacques, the street pilgrims to Santiago have been taking on their way out of Paris since the Middle Ages. Coincidence? Of course not. And it's another reason I was happy to go on this shopping expedition. When I explained to the Vieux Camper sales lady that I was thinking about buying a pelerin for my trip to Santiago de Compostela, her haughty Parisian smirk turned into a warm smile. She had been to Saint-Jacques, as she put it, and was eager to help me prepare for my trip. For the next half hour, this enthusiastic clerk was all mine, while she detailed the features.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.